Second in a series of three webinars that I'm doing, and the first one was the inspection database, and that is now recorded. John's doing some final polishing on the recording to save it, and I'll send that out with the instructions for the database. But I've been seeing a lot of people uploading station information forms, as well as in opening stations, as well as inspections. So I appreciate the activity, and this will be the dashboard for the whole program. So it's very important that we try to get everything up to date, and a good record for Brian Hirsch when he comes in here to relieve me. So the second one is A1 and A3 document forms. It's a Weather Service Forms A1, page 1, and Weather Service Form A3, page 1, technically. So you go back a long ways. They're out of date. They need to be redone, and we are working on that as part of the CSSA upgrade program. And Randy Breezer in La Crosse has taken a stab at creating an online version of this, which will be very nice, but it's still several months off before we'll see it. So we're still working in this realm. We have a policy that says we are to keep station information and keep NCDC informed of the metadata for all of the aviation, upper air, Marine, ASOS stations that are not co-op. These are others, you know, all the other sites besides co-op. So the policy guideline came out in a memorandum dated February 8th. The last time there was any policy in the Weather Service was when the directives came on into play, replacing the Weather Service Operations Manual chapters. There was a chapter A11 that went away that required the metadata to be kept up. Observing Services Branch came out with a policy memo, which I'll show you, that dictates as this is the required documentation that's needed to do the A1 and A3 form per the SIS manual, which is online, is on the MetDat drive. Email the forms to stations.ncdc@ncdc.gov. It would be good to copy somebody here. I'm not going to be here. But really, the most important part is getting it to NCDC, putting it on the station inspection database as a file folder. That's what that is a file folder of the current situation. It's always good to merge the A1 and A3 forms into one document, because you've only got three versions that you can save station information to the inspection database. And if you put it into Adobe, it's a smaller file and it's easier to open up by anybody and save. This is a policy letter. I'm sure you can't read it because I can't even read it on my screen. Dated February 8th. What it says, policy for metadata information has been neglected for a period of time, and we're officially going to comply with a new directive is going to officially be coming out, NOAA-wide policy for metadata. I haven't heard anything more on that, Jim, have you? Jim O'Sullivan?
Hi. I think I was on mute. It's holding off until we see how the Randy's work is done, and then we'll probably be editing it as a temporary solution until we get the actual written policy in.
Okay. So in the meantime, we're supposed to use the A1 and A3 form. Simple metadata forms being developed, and that's the one Randy's working on, will be merged into this new CSSA upgrade that's being worked on. There is a website. The A1 and A3 template forms are found on the DAD site. I'm sure you're all familiar with the Southern Region DAD site, which has a lot of different forms. Each copy should be submitted to NCDC for archive, one copy to the Regional Observation Services Program Manager, and essentially the file folder is where those should be kept, the inspection database, and the forecast office needs to keep a copy as well. This is a kind of a snapshot of the top part of the A1 form. It's more of the instrumentation, the elevations, the mechanics of the station, essentially.
Tom, I can't see that slide.
You cannot.
I'm
Anybody
not,
else not seeing it?
The intro slide, observations program.
I haven't seen anything yet.
Really?
Me either.
I've got it here.
I've got it in Marquette.
Got it in Chicago. Point.
Okay, Clip one.
Spring.
John, you're seeing it, right?
I'm seeing it fine. You, if you want to take the chance, you could always stop it and then get back on again. Not on the call. You can continue to listen on the call, but just stop your go-to webinar and then just click on it again and reload it.
Me or the people?
No, not you, the field. Yeah, because if others are getting it, then it's really kind of hard to tell. I don't want to lose everybody at once.
I tried that at the top of the hour and just now got in at about 8 minutes after. So that's how quick our bandwidth's running right now.
Okay.
So.
What office is that? I'm sorry, I didn't catch
it. I'm sorry, John. This is Keith and Gaylord.
Oh, okay. Let me go check on that. Anybody else having slowness? I'll go check with our IT folks. See what
Davenport's having slowness.
Davenport, okay. Thank you. Anybody else?
Hastings, obviously. We haven't advanced beyond the first slide.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay, let me go check with them, see what's going on. Okay, go ahead, Tom.
All right, I'll try to describe what I'm showing, and hopefully it'll catch up. The A1 page 1, part 1, essentially has two pages to it. There's, I think, probably the second page goes into the instrumentation. The first page deals with the station name, latitude, longitude, all the elevations, and the reason for the rendition. The second page of this A1, page 1, goes into the instrumentation. The wind system, the temperature system, the hydrothermometer, if it's an ASOS or an AWOS. We would not document AWOSs, by the way. We only document ASOS. We document the BSARs that uses backup equipment to support an AWOS failure, but not the AWOS itself. So that's essentially the A1 page 1. The A3 page 1 goes more into the program description of the station. Again, it repeats a lot of the latitude, longitude, and name of the airport. But it goes into has a first section in synoptic, which we don't do anymore. Then it gets into the aviation program, how many hours a day are scheduled reports. And then the time of the observations, if it's less than 24 hours. It gets into the type of remarks that are included, like pressure tendency and snow groups, et cetera. If it's a second order station, who the supervising office is, who the cooperator is, the hours of operation that they're going to be working, et cetera, and how to contact that cooperator. Elevations are very, 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 very important. I'm depicting here a picture of kind of an airport with a control tower out of the Manual of Barometry from 1963. There are very specific descriptions of these different elevations, which I want to take some time to go into. Field elevation is the highest point on the runway. Station elevation at that time, which is H sub P, is showing us 10 feet above the field elevation. That's no longer the case. If a new station is established and you're establishing a station elevation, it will be the same as the field elevation. Once station elevation is established, it is never changed. Unless you change the barometer elevation by more than 50 feet away from station elevation, then it requires permission from headquarters. They have to issue, for an ASOS for, in particular, they have to issue removal tables, which correct everything to sea level pressure, because it takes into account a different bunch of corrections, plateau correction, gravity correction, and so on. So the Ivory Point is the barometer, used to be a mercury barometer. Now it's the pressure sensor. Station elevation, again, is very important. Field elevation is the highest point in the runway. Those do change over time with airports extending runways and construction. Ground elevation is just plain H, and that's your that's the ground elevation below the temperature sensor. And then there's always a fixed point. That's usually the level of the finished floor in an ASOS situation. A little bit more worded description of this is the, I've got the screen up here showing the definition of ground elevation. And it's the elevation of above mean sea level for the ground at the meteorological station in feet. And it's the highest, it's the average height of the terrain contained within a circle having a radius of 65 feet centered on the temperature sensor. So when an ASOS moves, we always get the ground elevation where the from the FAA's documentation, the 7460, which allows them to do construction on an airport. We get that ground elevation, and that's what we use for the new H elevation on our documentation. It says accuracy should be to the nearest 10 feet. That's from our old days of looking at topo maps. Now that we have a FAA documentation in the form of a permission to do construction on an airport, that has to be accurate to the nearest foot. So we use that, and it's generally pretty accurate. Field elevation is H sub A, and it's the vertical distance above mean sea level for the official datum on the airfield. And this is surveyed and published by the FAA and NOS in the airport facility directory, and also the terminal procedures, which I've got links to their website showing. And those change all the time. We don't have a way to keep track of those, except when we do an activity of moving something on the airport. I usually go check those and provide those to the ETs. When they bring the ASOS back up, they will update the field elevation along with the barometer, whatever else they're moving. I want to go back also. The ground elevation is important in a, I'll go back up here. It's very important in the salometer. Both the ground elevation and the field elevation work together in the salometer algorithm, because you're going to report the cloud's height above the field elevation. So it's important to have the ground elevation in the algorithm, in the ASOS database, and the field elevation, because they work together. So it'll correct. The salometer is going to measure the clouds above where it is, the ground, and it's going to correct it to report above the field elevation, which in some places, the mountains could be 50 to 80 feet different, depending on where the ASOS is. The barometer elevation is very important as well. It's, it goes without saying. And it's generally the zero point of the barometer. And for an ASOS, it's the It's the level of the finished floor plus 2 feet. That's the height of the pressure sensor within the acquisition control unit. If it's a SARS, it's going to be the elevation of the two altimeters that they have. If it's a DASI in a FAA control tower, it's going to be the where their sensor is located. This is very important. It's got to be a surveyed value. It cannot be somebody saying it's about this or it's the floor is this high and just add 5 foot to it. We don't accept that. If it's vented, let's say an ASOS is vented because the tower is airtight and it needs to be vented to the outside air, it's still the elevation of the sensor. It's not the elevation of the vent leaving the building 2 floors below. Another very important thing about barometer elevation, it's got to be within 100 feet of the field elevation to work properly with the proper linearity of reporting pressure. There's been occasions where, like Denver is a 300-foot air traffic control tower, they wanted to put the ASOS in the room, they call the subjunction room, just below the cab. And we didn't allow that because it would be greater than 100 feet above the field elevation, which would be a bad altimeter. Front Range Airport was the same way. So we always have, this is the words I use when I'm working with an engineering company or a SARS. I need a surveyor to provide documentation on their letterhead, latitude, longitude, and the elevation, accurate to the nearest foot. And it's NAVD 88, which is the more recent datum. Climatological station elevation, I took this out of an old reference. We really don't use it much anymore. We had a meeting here in the last month, and a lot of the regional people that were here, none of us really remember ever using it. NCDC was here, and they were not sure about it either. But essentially, it's the same as the station elevation at the very beginning, and it's what climatology follows as state for station pressure. If you're looking at the highest pressure at an airport ever, climatologically, it's based on this climatological station elevation. So that's another reason why station elevation is so important to not change over time. It stays the same. Level of the finished floor. Again, this is reference to the survey that's done. That's usually what we ask for, and then we add 2 foot. This is a typical survey from a surveyor. It's got the stamp of a licensed land surveyor on it, which is what we require. This happens to be for Eau Claire, Wisconsin, moving the ASOS ACU to the air traffic control tower from the terminal. And he gave us the latitude, the longitude, the elevation of the floor, 884.36. So that goes in our file. You know, the way I look at it, if someday I provided an elevation to an ET after, you know, for when he moves the ACU and before he turns everything back on and starts broadcasting, and he puts the wrong number in there, an airplane crashes because they come out of the clouds and find the ground much closer than they thought, I've got this documentation. It's the due diligence that we have to do. It's the right thing. I'll just pause for a moment. Is there any questions along the way here?
Tom, this is Steve in North Platte.
Yeah.
I have a question about the ground elevation. You said in your slide you said it has to be to the nearest 10 feet from the USGS topo charts, but then you mentioned it can be to the nearest foot. And what was that from again, from the airport surveys? Was that what you said?
Yeah, the next slide here I'll actually show you. latitudes. See, this is, let me go down here. I'll get to that in just a moment. Essentially, the topo map is what we normally do because we, in the old days, we didn't have much better to get our elevations. It's like the co-op site. Now we have, anytime construction is done on an airport for an ASOS move, for example, we have the people that are going to do the construction have to apply to the FAA to get permission to do construction on the airport. How high is the tower going to be? How long is the equipment going to be on the airport? How close to the runway? All this stuff has to be approved by the FAA. So the proponent submits what's known as a FAA Form 7460-1. It spells out what they're going to do, when they're going to do it, what the elevation of the ground is, how high the projection is going to stick up above the ground at that location. The FAA comes back with a determination letter after they review it in a number of programs for airspace and other activities. They'll come back with a determination letter. When I move or work with people to move an ASOS sensor group, I get both the 7460 and the determination letter, keep it in the file here, and send it into the configuration management folks. But that is a good source for latitude, longitude, and elevation of the sensor group.
Excuse me, Tom, a question just came in. It says, are A1A3 forms required for airport stations that are already documented in CSSA as a C network station?
If it's co-op only, no. If it's an aviation program, yes. So if it's a SARS, a BSARS, an ASOS, it's got to be in the A1 and A3.
Okay, thank you.
That answer whoever asked, that answer your question?
Yeah, Tom, thanks.
Okay. So essentially latitude and longitude is in did I answer the previous question sufficiently? It was Steve, right?
I think it was
Yep.
Tim.
Okay. Steve, thanks, Tom. That answers it. I can just use the 7460.
Right. And that should always be available before we do any airport construction or move ASOSes. Latitude and longitude, okay, normally, as with always, rain gauge is the center of the universe for a location. And unfortunately, I didn't make a copy of the right page here. In the site survey, the original site surveys done back in the early 90s, you've got a list of initialization parameters. They always give the airport reference point. There is another page that lists the sensor group. And that will have the latitude and longitude of the sensor group. That's the number you should use for the A1 and A3. But you've got your magnetic declination here. At that time, that's always changing. You've got your station elevation, your field elevation, and your pressure sensor elevation, which they actually is the floor. You have to add 2 feet for the actual sensor elevation. And then you've got the sensor group elevation, which is the ground, 628-foot mean sea level. This is happens to be Benton Harbor, which is a recent relocation we did. So this was the original location at Benton Harbor. The next page here, I've got a 7460, and it's real hard to read, even for me. But on the over in this area right here, we've got latitude, longitude. We've got the datum, which is NAD. Looks like 83, that's latitude and longitude. And then you've got the ground elevation, 641, and the above ground level is 50 foot, and they're actually doing that for the glide slope tower. The ASOTS is right next to the glide slope tower at 37 foot with the lightning rod on top of it. The sensors are 33 feet above the ground. So we would use ground elevation, 641 feet. and we have our latitude and longitude. This is as close as you're going to get to the rain gauge unless you do your own calculation. But it's all within a cluster of maybe 40-foot separation at the max. That's an electronic 7460-1 form. Any questions on that? On the A1 and A3 form, again, follow the station information system, the SIS manual that's located on our MetDat drive under station information folder. Any questions? Okay, I'm going to minimize this. I'm going to...
I've got a question.
Yeah.
You said the barometer elevation is within 100 feet of the field elevation or the ground elevation?
The barometer sensor itself has to be within 100 foot of the field elevation to be considered accurate.
Perfect. Thank you.
Beyond that, it gets out of linearity throughout the scale. And it has to do with the column of air and the temperature expansion. That's why there is a limit.
Tom, this is Billy. I have a quick question also.
Yeah.
With respect to the barometer elevation, with the ACU is 2 feet from the finished floor.
Above the finished floor, yep.
And I believe SARS was the survey point itself, or the location rather.
Right.
You mentioned the third one, which I didn't hear, I thought. Or is that the only two you mentioned?
The DASI. And the DASI you're going to have to get from the FAA.
Okay, they'll have to provide
it. We really, and it's a sensor, probably, they have a 19-inch rack, 6 foot tall, typically in their equipment room in the tower. And it'll have a digital readout. You can see, actually, the pressure to the nearest thousandths of an inch.
Before the DASI and the SAR, it's the elevation height of the actual sensor.
It's always the sensor itself, yes.
Okay, thank you.
You bet. This is a station information system document that we have on our MetDat drive. And again, it's historic, but it's the only thing we really have, but it talks about the forms. And all the different entries on it and goes into detail. I'll get it open up here. So, for example, A1 page 1, it tells you how to fill all this in, the name, the station type, which ones to choose, the state. They got some codes there too, but all we're going to do is put in the state. And it goes on. So if you have questions about what they're really looking for, this is where you would go for detailed information. Give me just a second here.
Hey, John, this is Keith in Gaylord. While we're waiting on Tom, can I ask you a quick question?
Let's kind of work on Benton Harbor real quick. So we're going to, on this template here, if I can get it to respond.
All right, last
call for entry. Just fill in the blanks. We're documenting ASOS. We have new latitude and longitude. I don't have that in front of me real quick. I'm going to use the old number just for grins. It's sensor group location, you know. And I won't go through the whole thing, so, but they don't have, see, they only go to the nearest minute. So it's north, you can't put the seconds in there, the station elevation. Was 6:43. The date, I would go ahead and just use, because we don't have any, unless you've got a historic date already in an existing A1 and A3 form, use the source that you got it from. In this case, it's from the ASOS site survey of 02-28-91. Field elevation. And I want to show you where to get that from. FAA has Digital Terminal Procedures page. And you've got over here Digital Products, which allows you to pick from the Terminal Procedures, or you can get the Airport Facility Directory. The Airport Facility Directory is the old green books that we used to get in the office all the time. The Terminal Procedures are the approach plates for the airplane circling minimums and landing. Both of them have the field elevation on it. Go to the latest version. In this case, we're going to pick Michigan. Just click on Michigan. We type in the identifier, Benton Harbor, and do our search. It'll come up with a bunch of different approaches for different runways. Sometimes they have an airport diagram, but I don't see one here. So we'll pick the ILS runway just for the more complex. It's probably the primary approach. Right here at the top, you've got the airport elevation, 6:43. And so that is our field elevation and has not changed. If you look in this situation, they're telling you the touchdown zone for this runway, 28, is 6:37, but the highest point on runway is 6:43. That's where you get your field elevation. We put 6:43. Whatever the date of that document was, probably I'm thinking October 10-1. The ground elevation was 6:28, but it actually moved, so it was 6:40. Does somebody remember 6:40? 6:41, right? We're making this up as we go a little bit. And that was based on the move. And I believe that was 6:22:2011 of this year. The barometer elevation didn't change. That was pressure sensor elevation was 6:57, so it would be 6:59, adding 2 feet. And again, you can go into the ASOS if you still have the capability and look at the site physical page in the ASOS to see some of this data as well.
Hey,
and
Tom,
when was that? Yeah.
Quick question. Earlier, when I think it was the diagram, and you stated something that I misinterpreted, but with the station elevation versus the field elevation, I thought you'd mentioned something about a 10-foot difference.
Yeah, and that doesn't exist anymore. January Okay, station elevation is historical. It never changes. It was essentially, if a station existed, the height of the Ivory Point on the Mercury Barometer January 1st of 1900. It's a reference. In the manual barometry in 1963, a station elevation was for a new station is generally considered 10 feet above the field. But, and I think probably somewhere, I know I've been here since 79, so the, as far as back as I know, station elevation's always been the, when you establish a brand new station, as we did with many ASOSes, we made station elevation be the same as the field elevation, just as a given. We didn't follow the 10 foot above field elevation rule. That's been changed.
So HP can be equal to HA, that's what comes up.
If it's a brand new station, it will be.
Okay, that's what I wanted to put down. Thank you.
Yeah, you bet. Good question. I'm going to skip over the HPC because I don't have any reference on that. This would be a station relocated. I'll check that. I'm not going to mess with all the communication stuff that's in this next section. And you put your name here. And the date of the last rendition, which I think was 6. And the effective date of this one, which is the date of the move. Then you go into your equipment. And in this case, it's an ASOS. So we're going to say, using the legend up here at the top, it's an ASOS is the primary, so it's an X, and it's owned by this one, and Benton Harbor is FAA. It's an S100 is all you need to put in there for stock number. And when it was commissioned at this location, well, the original commissioning was actually, I've got those dates in a file. But looking at the historical document, it was 06-17-1996. That's all you need for an ASOS. Everything else is part of the ASOS. We don't need to have a separate wind tower or anything else. It's all included in that.
And anything with AWIS sites?
Pardon?
AWIS sites?
We don't document those, or we don't document AWAS. We only document ASOS. We also document, all the varieties of where observers are. So you've got the LARS, which is the FAA tower controllers. SARS backing up, SARS is a full observation program with our own equipment, including wind and balloons for sealing, and they have to have all the equipment. The backup SARS, BSARS for an AWAS, and a SARS-2 for an ASOS. A MARS station, which is U.S. Coast Guard, typically. Non-fed OBS, NF OBS, we've got 3 of those in the region. Paid A's, which we have 1 at Blanding, Utah. All get documented on here to the best of your ability. And so I'm going to close that. I'm going to open up the A3 form. And again, Benton Harbor, Michigan. I'm not going to worry about the code. It's an ASOS. Get that to a smaller scale where I can see it. Benton Harbor. It's going to be hard to type all that in there, but Southwest Michigan Regional Airport, location identifier. If we had an index number and it followed the station along the way, and that would be mostly for NWS and former FAA stations, we have index numbers. If those are still available, and CDC would like to have those, the county, I'm not sure what the county is, Holland, I think, but Berrien. George, are you on? He's not. Not worried about the congressional district, WMO region. I think we're region 4, aren't we? I think. We're not worried about AFOS. We're not worried about Synoptic. We're worried about aviation. And it's 24 hours a day. When less than 24 hours, we don't need to pull all that out. It does take species. Unscheduled as needed. Local time in that case would be Eastern. The elements, we got sea level pressure, altimeter. We don't have tower visibility. We have temperature, remarks, dew point, wind, sky visibility. They may or may not have runway visual range. That's something you have to find out locally. We have pressure tendency at all these 3-hourly times. Let me put an 8 in there. And we got water content with the snowfall, for example. And we'll go on and fill all those out. I'm not going to bother the details there. There is no form. And we'll just put ASOS as how it's recorded or capped. It's an ASOS. Again, put your name. Your title. And your date. Last rendition. And it's not upper air. Again, if you had upper air at your station, a WFO, for example, you would document that. International Falls would be, of course, that's all they do. Denver upper air station would all be documented. Other observations, it's not, Benton Harbor is really not a climatological site, not an LCD. If you're published, if you're having that station published in a CD, then you would click on the climatological box. I don't see anything else that would really apply in that. Other observations, it's not a paid second order. A paid second order would be, again, Blanding, Utah is probably one of our only ones. There's some up at Whitefish. Paradise, Michigan, we have Whitefish Point. We have a fisheries actually doing some backup to a automated system there. Those are the only two paid sites that we have. We do not document the snowpades on here. Those are, let's just say this is for a LCD site. We would actually put a remark down here, and that's we went over that in the documentation for this snowpade program. Let me see if I can find that handy real quick. So you would put in the remarks there, you put the snow network observation, latitude, longitude, and ground elevation. The site is located so many miles from, in the direction from ASOS. You would document that in the remarks. And again, the reason we're moving it is station relocated. Location of the office. It's really not an office, so I've seen some cases where you could put in the phone number for the voice here. But that's about all you'd have. There's really no mailing address. You could put the WFO mailing address there if you wanted to put an address in, but it's really not necessary. And that's about all there is to the A3 page one. Is there any questions there? Now, I don't know if save as, if you go down to the PDF, you can publish it. As a PDF, and we're going to see if we can save that. Another way to do it, if you have the capability, would be print as a PDF. I like that way actually better. That way you actually get to see your document. If you don't have Adobe Acrobat loaded on your machine, try to get your IT person to do that for you. So you end up with that document.
Tom, just excuse me, Tom, I was just going to let you know, you can also do a save as and select the file type as PDF also.
Okay, good.
So that works too.
We'll go to A1. We'll do the same thing there. Save as. Let's try that. And PDF. You save it. It may not show up. But I'm going to close that. Close that. I'm going to open up my A1, and then I'm going to where can I attach? Combine files. We've got the A1. I'm going to add the A3. I'm going to combine those into one document. I'm going to save it as EEH underline 06-22-11. Now I've got four pages, A1 and then the A3. Now, go to the inspection database and you should always use Mozilla Firefox for the inspection database.
Tom, did you have a question, answer a question about a tap for an airport? There was a question about, is an update to the A1A3 required if a WFO intends to start writing taps
for
an airport? Okay, just wanted to make sure.
This is only, in the past, there used to be a page about like services, the number of taps that we do. That was like A3 page 2, I believe. We're not doing that form anymore. There doesn't seem to be any interest or requirement. We're only doing the instrumentation and the observing program. I don't know whose reports these are. It's kind of a bogus station. So I'm going to go back here, and I'm going to add. Here's metadata. Okay, let's go to the metadata. We don't have, let's see if we have a bogus report in here, a bogus station. And we don't. So we'd have to create a station. But then you would upload basically to that station. I'm not going to do it. You would browse, you would find your document, there it is, and you hit open. I can always get it removed, and then you would add your document. But I won't do that. Tim was getting nervous there.
I have complete faith in you.
No, I can't get out of it. Okay, so there's still no document there. But that would complete your task. You make a copy in PDF. You know, if you got it in PDF, send it to stations at ncdc.gov. I think that was the name of it. And then they get their data and they put it in the archive for all the customers that they have to serve. So, have I confused everybody? There's an awful lot of quiet out there. Are there any questions I can answer?
Yeah, Tom, this is Petro here. Where's that metadata site at?
It's on the server. John, can you help with the directions to get to the metdat drive?
Yeah, so when we're done here, we'll send an email out with how to get to it.
Sounds good.
You include the slides, too?
Yes.
Yes.
Hopefully they're not too big. I might have to reduce it to a PDF if it's too big, but yeah.
Or put them on.
Yeah, Tom, this is Jeff at NCDC. That's an amazingly useful presentation. Even if I can't get to the MetDAT drive, I would love to have a copy of the slides.
You bet.
I can also put it up on Google, too, so everybody could get access to it.
Okay.
Even from home.
Wow.
and acknowledge we have Jeff Arnfield on the line with us from National Climatic Data Center. If there's any questions for Jeff.
We may also have Christy Thomas. I'm not sure if she managed to get on or not. She may be on here lurking as well. Now, I got to give you a belated title. There's a thing called a TWACT, T-W-A-K-T, which is an acronym for Person Who Actually Knows Things. And you have proven today that you definitely deserve that title.
I guess you stick around this long, it sticks once in a while.
Hopefully nothing more to wash off.
Randy, are you available? Can you show a little bit of what you've been working on?
Sure, I can do a quick run through there. We need to be done by, well, it's 10 o'clock right now.
We have it for 2 hours, so there's no urgency.
I can give a 1 hour presentation, sure.
I will let me see. Did I give that to you already?
I don't know. What do you see in there?
Change presenter.
I just sent it to him.
Oh, good. Okay. What I will say, though, my request is that you work very hard to document what you have, update that to the station inspection database so that we have a good database of what's out there and what we have right now in the current A1 and A3 forms that are available, this template. What Randy's working on is holds very good promise. I expect we'll be doing some testing next year, but we've got to get on the NIDS development server. There's a lot of obstacles and hurdles to go, but it will replace the need for paper as we know it today. It will produce a document, a PDF document, that we will provide to NCDC, as well as something you can, a snapshot of the moment, you can stick in your file. So this holds a lot of hope. We've had a lot of hopes before in the past. We've never gotten to the goal away from the paper. So my request is that you go ahead and try to document everything you've got now on the current stuff, get it in the database so that we all know what we have. And when we get to this, it'll be just a walk in the park to fill this out. Go ahead, Randy.
Oh, okay. What are you seeing there?
Got the got your window there. Your with your please log in ARX.
Oh, okay. Yep, I got the right screen then. I'll run through this quickly here. Basically, it's a database that with a form to fill it out after login. Log in as your WFO. You choose a state, and then you can. Now, there are AWASs in here because this is a test database, so don't let that throw you. None of the data that you're going to see is actually good. So I will take you to my favorite place, which is Lake Wobegon. And this is the screen that you'll be presented with. It's pretty self-explanatory, I guess. You see all the elements that Tom has described there, pretty much. I have some on the front page here. I do have some helps for finding some of the information that you need. There's some of the magnetic declination, for one, conversions, and then you fill out the form. I'll go through the tabs here pretty quickly. First one, of course, physical characteristics, then OBS programs, checkboxes, and free text to enter your information. Scheduled times, again, I'll just go through it here. It's probably self-explanatory. Rendition basis, some drop-down choices. Sensor data has another window of tabs. Am I going too fast, or is there lags here? Everybody seeing all of this?
Looks good, Bill.
Looks okay, Randy.
All right.
Looking good.
And then just pages for each one of the elements there. I will say that there is some, there's a little nuance here, I guess. Non-standard siding, you'll see a box appear for explanation. Pretty straightforward. And be able to upload a photo. And then finally the report, which would correspond with your A1, A3, this creates a PDF, and it's a temporary document, and it reflects whatever you've just put into the database. Once you are satisfied with the work you've done, you save it as a new rendition. It'll create a PDF, a permanent PDF file, and also a machine-readable delimited file. That's kind of a quick and dirty look at what's going on there.
So. Randy, this is John, and up under a program, you have SARS, mm-hmm. and what are the various types? Where it says Lake Will Be Gone.
Are you talking about the
next one over where it says SARS
program? Oh, okay.
Just so people kind of know what they're going to be
using. Yeah. For. Again, there's some things in there that won't be in the final version. We won't have the AWAS there, but also a few, let's see.
It's going to follow the same protocol as the station inspection database, right, Randy?
Yes. Yep. That's correct.
So there's a match.
There'll be some, techniques for adding new stations. A couple of ways to do that. You can load one of your stations. Let's go back again to Lake Will Be Gone. If you want to add a new station, you can just delete the current one that's in your service area and add all the information fresh. See, what else can I show you here? That's about it, unless you have some questions there.
This is very exciting, and I appreciate Randy's work on this. It's been years. Probably says, I bet Randy could do something like this. And then we had a program from Alaska, from Dale Rada. Who's retired, who Alaska, they were using something very similar to this, but it was much more simple. Randy's really, really done some nice work to make it robust and taken a lot of feedback from a lot of people in the regional offices and headquarters to modify it.
That's great.
Yeah, it's going to be nice.
Thank you, Randy.
Yep, sure. Thank you, Randy.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Well, Tom?
Yeah, any other questions?
Tom, yeah, this is Scott in Wichita. If you wouldn't mind, could you briefly summarize the best places to get those four elevations?
I have a document. Basically, what I have on these slides is the text, but I wrote a document 11 years ago, and it's still pretty good. It takes it from other sources. You know, I'm not creating information there. It just summarized it in all one page. And this was when Bi Capel was here, and we were trying to update all the A13 and A3 forms at that time. There was a big, big push to update everything, and we articulated all this in a page. I will send that out as well. But it the text is really essentially on these slides. Yeah, let's see, back to the...
Actually, one of the bigger aids was just that very basic illustration you had of the different...
Oh, I love that. I love that, really.
I'd never seen that one, actually.
It's old. Let me get it up here for you. I really like the visual, though. You know, if I could just correct that station elevation so it's the same as field. And my daughter's an artist, but I could probably get that done. That really says it all. Those are all your references. You got your ground elevation, your fixed point. In the earlier days, we used to have an A1 page 6, which did all the barometry, and it had the surveyor's reference on the airport and the benchmark, and that would be over on the far left. And then you'd have a fixed point, which you would chisel on the sidewalk just outside the air traffic control tower or the weather office. And then you would have the ivory point, which is the ivory tip of the mercury barometer. Those were all kept on a card and in the station information file. So if you've got old files, you'll find some of that history, which is really interesting to look at. Again, field elevation changes with the airport construction. And the surface is where your temperature sensor is. But then you got the different elevations. Again, these are the elevations that the definitions that you want to follow. And then where you get the field elevation. I got the two websites on that page. And the barometer elevation, which is your pressure sensor. And the elevation requirement for a surveyor. Those are the words, exact words that I always use. HPC, I don't use. I just put it in here because I thought it was, I found it. And then level of the finished floor, which is what the surveyor will provide for a move. Any questions?
This is the most relevant webinar I've had in maybe, I don't know how long, specifically to my job. I appreciate it.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, hey, this is Keith again. I just want to verify, we did record this whole thing, right?
Yes,
we did.
John's okay. Still recording.
Still recording. we've got everything on tape.
Okay. Yeah, that last comment, I've just been sitting here frustrated with technical problems the whole time, and I'm sitting here thinking, you know, this is the one webinar I've been waiting 8 years for.
You know? Oh, sorry.
But, as long as it's recorded, we'll get it. But thanks, Tom.
You will. All right. John, you can cut it off if you want.
Okay. And, Tom, thank you very much for doing these for us. We really appreciate it. It's been great. Thank you.
My